Well, my name's Mike Throne. I work for the Corps of Engineers. I'm a biologist, lead biologist for the Hatchie-Loosahatchie Mississippi River Ecosystem Restoration Study. And we're here today to hold a public scoping meeting, present some information to you all, and really hope to get some good feedback from you today. So I was going to turn it over to Robbie Tidwell. He's the manager here at Fort Pillow State Park. Wonderful facility. We're grateful for him to allow us to hold the meeting here. So, Robbie.
All right. Well, so I was just supposed to talk a little bit about where you're at, what we've done, and the last little bit here at the park. So the park itself is 1,642 acres, I guess, depending on which one you look at. Most of that is all in wooded area, but our main purpose here is, of course, is to preserve the historical features that make up Fort Pillow. So what we've done, of course, the museum where you are now, pretty much everything inside and out has been redone the last year for as far as gift shop and the panels and everything inside for the historical means of the museum. The campground renovations, picnic pavilion, group camp, and of course all the trails. So we've got several projects going on now that we're working on with soil erosion, which is our biggest feature that we face here, of course. We do a lot of dirt and rock work every time it rains. So it's pretty much what we do here is preserve history, try to provide a recreational opportunity while the people are here as well. And so we're glad to have you. I know that I just found out that the governor's conference was tonight. So a lot of the people that were planning on coming are at that. And then, of course, a lot of the farmers in the area are shelling corn right outside the park. So those are two things that sort of hit us for tonight. But Danny, and I know y'all came to represent for the ones that couldn't make it here tonight, so I appreciate y'all. And Mr. Rudy, thank you for coming too. So anyway, thank you.
Good evening. My name is Edward Lambert. I'm the Chief of the Environmental Compliance Branch for the Corps of Engineers in Memphis. And welcome to this scoping meeting for the Hatchie-Loosahatchie Ecosystem Restoration Study. Scoping meetings are an important component of our public involvement program for our studies. They allow us to obtain feedback from you, the public, and that's what we're here tonight for. We had a virtual scoping meeting when the study first kicked off. Since that time, the team has been very busy putting together tentative measures, and you'll hear about those measures tonight, those restoration measures, and have an opportunity to provide us feedback. We have a couple of presentations lined up for you tonight to tell you more about what the study's about, why you're here, and how you can provide comment tonight or throughout the public scoping period. So again, welcome. We're glad to have you. We don't have an overly large crowd tonight, so you get a lot of personalized attention. And without further ado, I would like to introduce Mr. Jason Henniker. He is the chair for the Lower Mississippi River Conservation Committee, and they are a non-federal cost-sharing partner. Jason.
Hello. Thanks for coming out tonight. Thank you for being a part of this process of the scoping meeting. We look forward to hearing from each and every one of you. This is just the feasibility study is just the next chapter in a long partnership between LMRCC and the U.S. Corps of Engineers Memphis District. I'm going to turn it over to Angie Rogers now so she can tell us a little more about how LMRCC has worked along the Mississippi River for so many years.
Thanks, Jason. Good evening, y'all. My name is Angie Rogers. I'm the coordinator for the Lower Mississippi River Conservation Committee. I'm also the project leader of one of our Fish and Wildlife Service offices, Lower Mississippi River Fish and Wildlife Conservation Office. I'm actually based in out of Tupelo, Mississippi, where our office is located, but we spend a lot of time over in the right along the river and on the river. So the purpose of my presentation is really to provide you a little bit of background about the LMRCC and kind of how we got to this point. And then Mike is going to follow me and give you more specifics on this project itself and probably, you know, kind of give you more of a understanding of like what this project is all about. So this is kind of to give you some background on LMRCC as the non-federal cost share sponsor. So the LMRCC, a lot of you may not be familiar with it. We do have koozies out front if you'd like to take one with you, though, just so you can remember what it stands for. But it is basically a partnership of the six states along the lower Mississippi River. It was formed in 1994, and each of those six states has a representative from their game and fish agency and also from their environmental quality agencies that sit on our executive committee, or our board, basically. So we have a 12-member board of state agency partners, and then Fish and Wildlife Service provides a full-time coordinator to the LMRCC. And as I said, we were established in 1994. We cannot do, really, the organization was formed because the Mississippi River, with the exception of Louisiana, is the border of all these states. And it's a really big river, and folks, the states realized a long time ago they really needed to work together on fisheries management, natural resource issues. So that's why the LMRCC was formed. We focus on information exchange, conservation planning, and habitat restoration, and I'll talk just a little bit about some of those things. First thing I want to mention is an important piece of legislation that ties directly to why we're here tonight. So in Water Resources Development Act of 2000, there was authorizing language that basically authorized this Lower Mississippi River Resource Assessment. And so this was a study of the entire Lower River from the confluence with the Ohio down to the Gulf. And there were three different parts of it. What information did we need for river-related management? What are the natural resource habitat needs along the Lower River? And what are those river-related recreation and access needs? And I heard you say boat ramps earlier, and that was a big one. We all recognize there is not enough boat ramps on the Mississippi River. But this study was authorized in 2000. So I'm kind of going on a timeline here, so I'm not going to talk about this until the end. So don't forget this. It's kind of important. So that was in 2000. So LMRCC has been, you know, after it formed in 94, it was basically, you know, getting established and figuring out, okay, what are priorities and where are we going to work and how are we going to work? And so the organization put together what we called our Restoring America's Greatest River Plan. And this was compiled in 2004. And this was basically a collaborative effort we held state-level planning meetings. And we went to each of those states, and we invited as many agency people that, you know, and other folks that wanted to come and provide input. And it was compiled into, these are just example maps that you can see here from Tennessee and Arkansas. And so it was basically a big laundry list of potential projects. Now, these were not necessarily projects that had been through a feasibility process, but it was, you know, you had a lot of folks with a lot of knowledge of the river. Maybe they worked on the river and said, hey, you know, this particular secondary channel on the river needs better connectivity. Let's put a dot on the map. And then it was kind of compiled this big list that then we started prioritizing and working our way through to kind of establish our work plan. All of this information is available on our website at lmrcc.org, where you can find the document itself and then all of the associated maps as well. If you look at this, this list on the left here is kind of the types of projects that were identified of interest on the river. And so you've got everything from, you know, restoring tributary mouths, improving boat ramp access, there you go, notching dikes, restoring secondary channels, restoring lakes and backwaters. And so we had a list of like 239 projects. Well, where do you start? Well, we looked at this, and of course you see that the highest number of projects is restoring secondary channels. And it turns out that we were able to establish a really unique and exciting partnership in order to do this type of work. And so it really took off. And so this is kind of where LMRCC has focused its restoration work since 2006. So this photo at the top is at Island 63. So this is, if you're in Clarksdale, Mississippi, and you go west, you're going to hit Island 63. But this was the first notch that we did. Does this have a pointer on it? The top one is? Oh, my gracious. I don't know if I can operate this, but I'll try. Okay, so this is a dike in this secondary channel here. So it's basically, like you see here, the rock rock dikes that if you've been on the river, you're probably familiar with these rock dikes. And essentially, what was happening is these rock dikes will cut off these secondary channels from main stem, so they don't have that flow and that interconnectedness for species to use, for paddlers to use, for anglers to use. These are great fishing areas. And so we really started focusing our efforts on these secondary channels. Now I broke it. Thank you. Okay. So this is showing you a graph of the, I'll try to break this down for you. So each of the bars, the individual bars, is the amount of dredged material in a given year. So you can see this starts back in the 40s. And the different colors on each bar is based on which Corps of Engineers district the dredging takes place. The big picture that I want you to get is from the 1940s to 2012, is as far as this graph goes, you can see that the amount of dredge material is on a decline, right? So over time, we're having to dredge, the Corps is having to dredge less and less material on the river. The blue shading, the black line with the blue shading behind it that is moving up during that same period of time, is the cumulative number of dikes, or the cumulative dike length in the river. The whole point of this is to show that the construction of dikes on the river is a fantastic channel improvement feature because it does what it's supposed to do, which is help the river maintain a self-scouring navigation channel. So you don't have to do as much dredging. It's very expensive to dredge. So these dikes work. They do their job. But there is a consequence. And that has, this is kind of illustrated here on this slide. So the yellow, pretend, is a sandbar. So you can see those black lines, those are the rock dikes. And as the water is moving downstream, they're basically, those dikes are helping to push water into that main stem, into the blue, to keep it scoured. But all that sediment is accumulating and creating bigger and bigger sandbars. And so all we're doing is going in and just removing small sections of those dikes so that you can have flow. And especially as the river elevation drops, then it allows for that connectivity between the secondary channel and the main channel. And those are really important habitat areas and recreational areas as well. This is a Loosahatchie bar. I'm going to show you a couple of examples of projects that we've done. So if you are in Memphis and you're traveling on the I-40 bridge over into Arkansas, if you look to the right, that is Loosahatchie bar. And right now you can see it really well. I was just through there last week. It's very obvious, and you can see the dike notching that's been done in that secondary channel. This was a project we did in 2008 in partnership with the Corps of Engineers Memphis District. So their river engineering team has been working with us for a very long time to accomplish this. So you can see kind of the schematic at the top of where all the green dots are, all areas where we put notches in dikes. And then they've come in and done some other improvements. But this basically took us about 22 days to do all the construction work associated with this, and it opened up about 11 miles of that secondary channel habitat. So this was a really exciting project that we worked on. This is another one that we just completed last month in August, and this is at Densford Dike Field. If you're familiar with Meeman Shelby Forest State Park, if you go just north from the state park, you'll hit Densford Dike Field. And you can see this the Google Earth image over there on the left. There was actually three dikes in this field, and we put five notches total in. You can see that's denoted by the yellow arrows there. And then this kind of is a, we had had a drone, had some good drone footage to show you that picture. I'm going to put up some links, too, of where we've got pictures and videos and all that. You can get a lot more information on all this work. So there's our YouTube channel. We actually have a YouTube channel. I don't know much about it, except it's really cool, and they put great videos on it. But we have a great photographer and videographer that does really great work for us. The map on the right just shows the projects that we've done to date. So we have, with the work that we just finished up our construction season just a couple of weeks ago, and so we have about 32 projects that have been completed. Most of those are secondary channels. I'll give you an example of another type of project we've done in just a minute. And we're at about 115 miles of secondary channels that have been restored on the lower miss. This is just another example of a type of project that we've done. This is in Louisiana on their Richard K. Yancey Wildlife Management Area. And so this area, you can see in this picture on the left, if you kind of look, you can see a series of scar lakes. And so this is within the Batcher. So it's on the riverside of the levee. And there was an old weir that you can see where that white blob is there. That's where we've just recently restored the weir. But there was a weir there that would retain the water in those series of scar lakes. And this is a really, really important area for commercial fisheries and for recreational fishing as well. But that weir dilapidated years ago, and the state agency was really interested in getting that weir restored. And so LMRCC was able to obtain some grant funding, and we were able to restore that weir. And then we also, as part of this project, have several culvert replacements denoted by the stars to try to better connect all the streams within the wildlife management area itself to allow for that connectivity. This is a really important area for gar to use, and so we do have some monitoring going on by the Nicholls State University researchers to kind of show how this restoration effort is affecting those species. So, remember that first slide, one of the first slides, and I said this was from 2000, and there was Lower Mississippi River Resource Assessment, and it's important, remember that. Okay, so that study was authorized in 2000, and the way that the legislation works through a Water Resources Development Act is you get authorizing language, and it may say that you're authorized to spend a certain amount of money on a project, but you may not get that money for a while. Well, 2012 is when we got the money for that project. So it took us 12 years to go from authorizing language to actually having funding to start this study. So this study we started in 2012. And it took us about 3 years to do the study, and then we had a period of review and all before that report went to Congress in 2016. And essentially, I mentioned earlier that we had these three different assessments, but then the recommendations that came out of that study were focused on these three things that you see here: a data science and communications program, a habitat restoration and management program, and a recreation program. So, follow with me. So there's our three programs, see the color coding. And I've got the red box around conservation reach studies. So within those recommendations, or within that process of that study, we identified 8 conservation reaches. The Lower Mississippi River is 954 river miles. That's a whole lot of river. And so how do you break down that river into manageable chunks? So we broke it down into these 8 reaches. And then the authorization for doing a feasibility study on one of those conservation reaches is what brings us here tonight, because that was authorized in Water Resources Development Act of 2018, and we just started on that in July of last year. So this is the whole, why you're here tonight is to understand more about this particular conservation reach, this Hatchie-Loosahatchie reach. And I think, I've got just a couple more. So again, this was the signing ceremony that we had in July of last year. That's there in Memphis. And so for this study, this is a Corps of Engineers study process, and each of those has to have a non-federal cost share sponsor. And so LMRCC signed on the dotted line to be the cost share sponsor for this particular study. The LMRCC is incorporated as a 501c3 nonprofit entity. That's kind of where we are. You can see on the map on the left shows you those other 7 reaches, but we're just going to be focusing tonight on the Hatchie-Loosahatchie. And then that's just contact information and several different websites, and I can provide this to anybody. I think that's all I've got. So, Mike, if you want to jump in.
Sure. This forward and backward. Okay, gotcha.
Yeah, I don't know. I just used the forward.
All right.
Thanks, Angie. So, again, my name's Mike Throne. I'm the project biologist for this study, as well as the National Environmental Policy Act coordinator. I was going to show this first slide here. What are we doing here, right? What is the purpose of this scoping meeting? So scoping is a process laid out in the National Environmental Policy Act, or NEPA. So NEPA is the basic charter for environmental protection, basic national charter for environmental protection. And scoping is a process laid out in NEPA where it allows us, the federal government, to inform the public of some proposed activities of our study, and that's what we're going to do today, as well as to solicit input from you all. So we really want to determine the scope of those significant issues and concerns. We want to eliminate any issues that are not significant and really focus on developing alternatives and a recommended plan. Ed mentioned earlier that we held a virtual scoping meeting last October. So that virtual scoping meeting was early in our process. We had just kicked off the study. After a few months, we had some good conceptual type ideas, and we presented those back in October. That's posted on our project website, which you'll see a little bit later. And since that time, we've been working to really focus on taking those concepts, those ideas, and getting them laid out on the landscape. These are some areas we think this ecosystem restoration measures will work. So that's the focus of what we have. I'm going to present some example measures that we have, and then we also have a series of all the measures we have laid out and a series of maps in the back of the room, and we're going to leave enough time to get you all out there and get some feedback from you all, site-specific feedback on those measures. So here's just a quick agenda of what I'm going to do in this presentation, a quick background authority information, go over the study area, describe it a little bit, really get into some of those proposed measures, and then leave enough time to really hear from you all. So we have written comment forms if you wanted to provide feedback today. The very back of the handout that we gave out is a series of questions that we'll go over. You're welcome to fill those out in writing today and leave them with us. Or we'll have our project email and website that you can also provide information if you want to do that at a later time after you think about things. So this is a slide. Angie showed it just a moment ago. So again, this is the first conservation reach out of those 8 priority reaches that came out of that LMRRA report. So we're excited to really get into ecosystem restoration. This is the first time we've really taken a large-scale ecosystem restoration approach on the Lower Mississippi River, and we're excited to get started on this study. So this is the authorizing language in Word of 2018 that authorized this particular study, this first conservation reach. And then she mentioned we received funding last July, so you can see there in 2021 is when we received the funding and kicked off this particular study. So our study area. So it extends from about River Mile 775, about where the Hatchie River comes into the Mississippi River, and extends all the way down to Wolf River Harbor, or right at the city of Memphis at River Mile 736. So when you look at the lateral extent of our study area, it's bordered along the west bank, on the Arkansas side, if you will, by the mainline levee system, and then the high bluffs on the east bank. So it's really that active floodplain. We're looking at ecosystem restoration in the main channel of the Mississippi River, as well as that active floodplain. It does go up some of the tribs, and we have it delineated out to the extent of the last big flood we had in the 2011 flood. So in terms of problems and opportunities, so this is a really complex slide you see up here. This is what's called a conceptual ecological model. So that previous report, that LMRRA report that we've been talking about, it laid out this conceptual ecological model where it really goes in depth of describing what the drivers are out there, what the stressors are, and what those ecological effects are of the stressors. So I'm going to attempt to summarize this pretty quickly. I'm not going to go through that whole diagram, of course, so just bear with me as I summarize this in a few words. So we all recognize the importance with the flood risk management system we have out there, the levee system. So we're reminded of that with every high water event we have. That levee system is important for our alluvial valley, of course, but it has restricted the floodplain and some of those habitats that are out there as well. So you know that forested area that used to encompass most of the alluvial plain, you keeping the water off has allowed the agricultural areas to continue, the channel improvement program is equally as important. So the channel improvement program really has allowed navigation to continue up and down the river, but it's also essentially locked the channel in place compared to what the river used to do. So the river's not allowed to meander across the alluvial valley anymore, of course. So a lot of these habitats, these old oxbows, these secondary channels, a lot of the aquatic habitats out on the floodplain, so they're not getting created like they used to be, not to the extent. And those aquatic habitats that are out there, as it's been disconnected, are starting to fill in over time. So we're really looking at some opportunities where we can restore some of those ecosystem functions, some of those dynamic processes that are out there. When you talk about land use, so the forest that we have out in the active floodplain is obviously increasingly important since there's not as much forest with the levee system in place, and the forest that is out there, for some of the past forestry operations, a lot of your mass-producing species that are important for deer and other wildlife, like your oak and other hard mass species, aren't as prevalent out there on the floodplain. So you see a lot of the forest community compositions being made up of your sugarberry, hackberry, cottonwood, sycamores, those types of communities, soft mass species, and not as much as that viable food for wildlife. We talk about climate change. So a lot of these areas, especially these old oxbows and secondary channels, as those droughts in the summertime become longer and it's disconnected more in the summer, so that just stresses those aquatic systems out. As the dissolved oxygen drops out, you know, the aquatic environment has trouble keeping up with that, and you have fish kills and other things that can happen. So those are some of the problems and opportunities we're looking at for this study. We realized pretty quick that even breaking up our large 934 river miles into eight conservation reaches, even this 139-mile reach, that's a big area, right? That's a big area, and how do you get site-specific ideas and measures out on a big area like this? So we realized pretty quick we really need to break this up into even smaller chunks and to be able to get a good understanding and have a deep dive into these opportunities out there. So we compiled a series of layers through a GIS platform. We used some of the terrain data we have out there. We use historic maps to really break up our study area into what we're calling geographic complexes. So we have 11 geographic complexes identified. We have maps of all these out in the hall that we can go look at after this presentation, where we have all these measures identified and really jump into what we're proposing out there. We used layers that some priority areas that like Angie had mentioned before, that other agencies have identified, like the Lower Mississippi Valley Joint Venture, their forest breeding bird priority areas. We've got some important spawning habitat for alligator gar that U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service has identified, and soils data that NRCS provides, and all these important data that's out there. We've compiled it in one place and sat down and really taken a deep dive into it to try to get some ecosystem restoration measures out there. So in terms of our overall goal and objectives, so our overall goal really is to restore those ecological structure and function to the whole mosaic of habitats out there. So we're not focusing on just one type of habitat. We really want to focus on that dynamic processes, how interconnected all those habitats are. We want to be able to do some good across all those different habitats. We did break it up into four main objectives. The first objective really focuses on the vegetative mosaic. So you've got the forest, like we mentioned earlier. You've got all your wetland habitats that are important for waterfowl and a lot of your fish spawning species that spawn out there on the floodplain. You've got some rare vegetation like river cane. There's documentation in the literature that the river cane and the cane brakes that used to be out there on the Mississippi River have been reduced by up to 98%. So that's a huge reduction, and it looking for some opportunities there to be able to restore some of that river cane. So there are remnant stands out there, so anything we can do to restore to those habitats that are left is one of our focal areas. We've talked about the mass producing species in our bottomland hardwood forest, fewer oaks than what was here historically. And then there's also community types like cypress tupelo swamps, which are also not as prevalent as they used to be, which are important for various wildlife. Our second objective really focuses on large river habitats. So this is focusing on a lot of the dike notching measures like Angie had presented. This is those obligate riverine species, so those species out there on the river that need that permanent flow. We've got a series of measures that address those large river habitats. Our third objective really focuses on floodplain water bodies and increasing connectivity to those. So that's your floodplain lakes, those your borrow areas, which function very well as floodplain lakes. You have your old meanders, we're calling meander scarps, so old meanders that have been cut off but are still remnant out there on the floodplain. Your sloughs, crevasses, several other those aquatic water bodies that are out there. And then our fourth objective, it's essentially like a secondary objective. So recreation has been mentioned several times as important. It was documented extensively during the LMRA report as an important need out there. Our ecosystem restoration policy doesn't allow for us to formulate specifically for recreation, so we're not talking commercial marinas or anything like that. What we're really talking about are taking advantage where those access to public spaces may be now compatible with our ecosystem restoration project. So primitive ramps, allowing people, if we restore a certain water body, to have access to it, et cetera. So we have some of those identified as well. So related to that first objective we had, this shows some example measures we have for that vegetative objective we have. Things like cypress tupelo establishment. So we mentioned that being a rare community type out there. So we've got some low-lying areas that are ripe for restoration of that cypress tupelo community. So they already get the appropriate hydrology. So it's really just getting those species reintroduced out there and having some protection mechanisms so they can continue. We talked about the importance of mass species for the bottomland hardwood forest we have out there. So anywhere we can restore bottomland hardwood forest, find some opportunities to plant some new forest and really promote those diverse mass producing species would be beneficial as well. Seasonally herbaceous wetlands is another focal area, so that's important for waterfowl. Riparian buffers, of course, both along the Mississippi River and some of the other flow paths and sloughs and ditches that are out there, maintaining that riparian buffer provides benefits as well. And then we talked about river cane as well. So another one of our example measures, Angie presented this extensively, the dike notching measures. So this is related to our objective number two. Attempt to, oh, no, I don't. Hold it. Okay, there we go. Okay, so dike notching. So if you look here, this is the IM-35 Dean Island Complex. So we have a map of this out in the hallway, but this is an example within this complex. Try this again. Okay, so if you can see this secondary channel that extends from the main channel and down along Dean's Island. So there's a series of old dikes there that they're so old they're not even rock dikes. So they call them pile dikes. Essentially, it looks like a series of telephone poles. And that was they don't serve a channel improvement function anymore. The channel has established itself out here along this outside bend. So these old pile dikes here don't serve a channel improvement function anymore. You can see a picture of what those look like and how they've essentially allowed a sediment has filled in behind those pile dikes. So we have an opportunity there to go through, notch those old pile dikes. We plan to leave some of them still standing. So some of them do collect large woody debris like trees and things that are important for fish and aquatic macroinvertebrates that the fish feed on and some structure, but really getting a good low flow channel through there would provide some good benefits. Another example measure we have, this one's related to connecting a meander scarp. So this is an old meander. This is part of the Sunrise Island, Island 34 complex. So if you look up here at the top, we've got a series of measures to increase connectivity throughout this whole long old meander. So this used to be the main channel of the river. The river had cut itself off since that time. And that old meander, that meander scarp, starting to fill in. So what we have proposed here is up at the top is installing a river training structure to help divert water into that meander scarp. And as you make your way through, there's a bridge you see here, item 4B. So you can see the debris that's collected behind that bridge. So if we're able to lower the invert underneath that bridge and allow that channel to scour itself out and really establish that low flow channel will help that as well. There's also an old pile dike down here at the bottom that you can see. Notching that old pile dike will help establish this low flow channel and get rid of some of that accumulated sediment. So this is another measure we have proposed. The next measure we have is related to objective 3, and it's really about some of those floodplain lakes and borrow areas. So this is out on the floodplain. The best example we have for this is in at the very bottom of our study area, the Hopefield Point Big River Complex. I'm going to attempt to point out we've got, this is Interstate 40 that you see that crosses the river. And then you have Interstate 55 to the south. Oh, this pointer is hard to use, but Interstate 55 to the south. And then you even have the mainline levee system along the west side there. So all of those features used borrow areas, you know, for building the levee system and the interstate system. So you see there on the right a series of borrow areas that have started to fill in over time. And this kind of shows you what some of those proposed measures are. So this is us sampling a borrow area. So typically those borrow areas were dug to around 8 to 10 feet. As you can see there, we're standing on the bottom. They filled in all the way to about 3 to 4 feet. So you're missing a lot of that deep water habitat. We're proposing to come in and create some habitat complexity, create things like islands, sinuous shoreline, maintaining that forested buffer. All those things will help restore some of that complexity for fish and wildlife. The next example measure I have is about increasing connectivity to some of these floodplain water bodies. So this is our Hatchie Towhead Randolph Complex. So this is where the Hatchie River comes into the Mississippi River. The lower Hatchie National Wildlife Refuge is located there. And I'll attempt to point you to where we're looking. As you come up the Hatchie River, you'll see these blue dots here. There's a little flow path that extends up into this floodplain lake, and there's a field adjacent to it. So That's what you're seeing on the right-hand side. You've got a series. You've got two obstructions, such as culverts, that seem to be undersized, that restricts connectivity up to this floodplain lake. And you can see here this cross section here, or this contour map really shows you that it shows the elevation of that adjacent field. So this one's unique in that the field adjacent to that floodplain lake is a really low elevation field. So it gets wet on it. This is an average water year, 2017. Water stays out on that field for nearly a month. And I'm going to get to why that's important on this slide here. So there's a species of fish known as the alligator gar. And alligator gar are becoming increasingly important out here on the lower Mississippi River because they're one of the only native predators that the invasive carp out there on the river for those invasive carp. So it's been identified in the lower Mississippi River Basin invasive carp control strategy framework that was published just a few years ago. So promoting those native predators and competition to those invasive carp is one of the main strategies there. Alligator gar spawn out on the floodplain, but they're fairly unique in that they don't spawn in the forest. So they need actually non-forested, low-lying fields with the appropriate hydrology where water can back up onto these wetland-type environments. Their eggs adhere to the vegetation out there. And if the water is warm enough, then they are able to have a successful spawning and rearing. Before they make it out onto their spawning location, so this is U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service's Habitat Suitability Index. These areas in pink and red show those prime alligator gar spawning areas. That's that field we talked about. So that blue adjacent to it, that's a floodplain lake. So gar also need a staging area before they make it to the floodplain. So that floodplain lake really does provide a good opportunity for the gar to come in, stage. As the water temperature comes out on that field and the water temperature starts to increase, that allows them to move out onto the floodplain and have a successful spawn. So that concludes all the example measures I have. Again, we have a lot of measures proposed, and they're all broken out into those 11 geographic complexes. All those maps we have out in the hallway show those measures. We have a summary table that goes along with them, and we can help explain those to you and really want to get feedback from you all. So, this is stuff that we've put together the best we could, looking at all those different layers on our computer, data layers using together. But we really want to get feedback from you all. If they make sense, what do you think of them? If there's site-specific areas that you have in mind that we don't have identified, we want to hear from those too. So we have extra copies of maps. We can write on them and really provide us the best feedback you can. So I put some sample questions here of the types of information if you wanted to provide those to us. These are on the very last page of the handout we gave out. So if you wanted to provide written comments, you can do that in writing. We put these here just to help kind of spur your thought processes. Did we describe the problems and opportunities? Are there others that you may feel that we need that would help improve ecological functions for the benefit of fish and wildlife that you want us to know about? Please let us know about those. Any other concerns or issues you may have? Additional measures? Any other data modeling needs or data that you may be aware of? We'll be interested in receiving that information. Any specific locations, obviously, would be great to know. And we got plenty of maps out there that we can help talk through. And then we're also interested in the real estate aspect. So if you have land that you feel is ripe for ecosystem restoration, that would be great to know. If you're interested in selling it, in fee simple, that's what this shows, that would be great to know. Or if an easement would be make sense to you, some type of easement, we would like to know that as well. So this is all the types of information. We have lots of opportunities out there, but that's all they are at this point. You know, nothing can be done without landowners, you know, willing and wanting to partner for these ecosystem restoration purposes. So it's all about hearing from you all, and that's what we're going to do for the remaining time today. So I'm going to close with this slide here. This is our project website. If you're interested in providing information, you can do so to the email address up here, or in writing to that mail address there at the Memphis District Corps of Engineers. Our project website, we're going to keep up to date. If you filled out a comment card, you'll be on our distribution list, so we'll continue to send you updates as we post them to the website. That's kind of our main source of getting information and putting the most up-to-date information out to you all. So winter comments due. We have a notice of intent. It's another step of the NEPA process is issuing a notice of intent when you perform an environmental impact statement, which we're doing for this study. That notice of intent is going to get published in the Federal Register within the next 2 weeks, and our comment period is going to extend for 30 days after that. So essentially, it's about the end of October is when that comment period will close. We'll send notification as soon as that notice of intent's in the Federal Register and get that notification out through press releases and on the website, as well as through our distribution list to document that. So that's all I have. I want to thank you all for coming and hope to hear from you out in the hall, either with providing written comments or we can talk through some maps. So thanks. Thanks, everybody.